Hey guys, good afternoon. I hope I am visible and audible to you all, and the audio and visual quality is all good. So give me a quick confirmation of that and then I will start. So in this particular class, short 30-minute session, we'll be talking about GU radiology and the must-know images from that. Okay, so I am just waiting for your confirmation if I am visible and audible, and then I shall begin. So, just to quickly introduce myself, my name is Zainab Bora, and I have done my MPS and MD in radiology from AIIMS New Delhi, and I finished my senior residency from there as well. And today at an academy, we shall be talking about very important images for NEET PG as well as FMG examination from GU radiology. Okay, so just waiting for your guys' comments because it takes some time here on YouTube, so there's a bit of a lag, so we will just have to work through that. In the meanwhile, Plus subscription is available for An Academy as well as Iconic subscription, where you get the advantage of An Academy as well as Prep Ladder, so you get live classes as well as recorded classes from the best faculty of the country. And this is the process of subscription. You get various time points packages, so you can use my code, which is ZVORA. So now I think I am basically getting your comments. All right, cool. So am I visible and audible? Everybody who has joined in, is the audio quality fine? Then I shall begin talking, although I have already begun. So these are the batch courses which are going on an Academy Plus platform for INICT as well as for next exams which have started. So today we have a crash course which is lined up. All right, amazing. So we have a crash course which is lined up in the night from 9 to 12. So there's a slight change in the timing. Earlier it was 6:30, now it's been rescheduled at 9 o'clock. So 3 hour crash course where I want to do complete toxicology with you guys, and as well as integrate it with psychiatry as well as medicine, all the protocols and everything about the management. So this is something that'll be very very highly for your examinations. All right, so do make it a point to see it. If not live, catch the recorded version on the app. And on Tuesday, day after tomorrow, we have an image crash course from all your clinical vignettes, image-based clinical vignettes, where we'll be taking into account radiology images. Okay, and this is the next batch course which I was talking about, and you have grand tests which are going on an Academy every weekend, so you can attempt them and get your live ranking, all right, on the app. So let's begin with the GU radiology. So we the common theme in your exam as far as GU radiology goes, you get a whole bunch of IVP images, all right, very very important. So that is going to be the theme, common theme today. In the first half, at least the former part of the class, we'll be looking at all of the images as far as IVP goes. Okay, yes, I do other subjects also. I'm taking into account all the requests that you guys are making on Telegram. So one thing at a time, I'm trying to get them done before your exam. So let's begin, guys. What is this IVP? What do you think? This is something which is must know. So I will zoom into the image for you so that you can see it better. Okay, so here we can see that first of all, you can see the abdominal X-ray. You can see the kidney on the right side, which is excreting the contrast. And then what do I see here at the distalmost end here? This is where your focus attention should be. I am seeing that there is a cystic dilatation. Do you see this? There's a dilatation of the distalmost part of the ureter. And when you see something like this, correct, this is very very important. So this is the adder head appearance. All right, adder head, or also called as cobra head. So we'll be talking about snake bites today in the night. So this is a radiological counterpart of that. So adder head or cobra head appearance is what we are seeing here, and this is basically representing urethrocele. So a few things about urethrocele. They are mainly of two types. Okay, one is a simple urethrocele that you are seeing here, where it's a eutopic location. So the normal location of your ureter, and then you have a cystic dilatation. That's a simple urethrocele. But if it opens ectopically, a lot of time you will find this, that you have an ectopic urethrocele, and that is usually associated with a duplex moiety. All right, so I will talk about that in a minute. But when you have a duplex moiety, you can also have an ectopic urethrocele. All right, so those are the two types. One is single, one is ectopic. All right, apart from that, what else? One variation that I want you to know is something called as a secourethrocele. This is something you might not have heard before. So secourethrocele is a rarer variant where the entire cystic dilatation that you are having prolapses. All right, prolapses further down into the bladder neck and into the urethra. So prolapsing kind of cystic dilatation is called secourethrocele. All right, so this is something which is extra edge that you should know. So it's possible that the other side is non-functional. functional here in this case. Okay, that is why you are only seeing unilateral, basically IVP wetting form. So a lot of times you might have agenesis or a non-functional kidney on the other side that can lead to only one side getting visualized. So in such cases, we'll do an ultrasound and see what's the case. Is the kidney there? It's not functioning. It's hydronephrotic or it's agenetic. Okay, so that is why you are only seeing right side here. Cool, little soul. Alright, so this is the first image, uretroscene. So a few pearls about that, it's done. Now what we are looking here, tell me the sign. This is something that every person who's attempting PG will know this sign. Okay, it's very typical. The name itself, basically the image itself tells you that it's looking like a drooping lily. Okay, but the drooping lily sign, what it represents is something where a lot of confusion arises. All right, so the drooping lily sign is seen with a duplex moiety. Correct, there's a duplex moiety. You can see very clearly that on the right side here, that this particular thing, pelvic alveolar system, is looking like a drooping lily which is falling down and drooping. Okay, so basically when do you see this? So you see this when you have a duplex moiety. So the here you need to know something called the Wiegert-Mayer law. Okay, this is something which we have discussed a lot of times before on the app. So Wiegert-Mayer law is something where they describe the complications of the upper moiety, lower moiety. So remember our golden rule, vowels stick together. Okay, I think most of the students here have attended my classes before. You guys know what I'm talking about. So upper moiety, vowels stick together. What are the complications that will happen here? Like we saw, adder head. So uretroscene will happen here. Apart from uretroscene, what did we see? Uretroscene can be ectopic. So the ectopic uretroscene falls here. Okay, apart from that, it can also undergo obstruction. So all the vowels sticking together with the upper moiety. All right, apart from that, what will happen to the lower moiety? So the lower moiety typically undergoes reflux. VUR. So because of all of this, because of obstruction and ectopic and uretroscene, this particular upper moiety a lot of times will become non-functional. So what you are not seeing here is actually the non-functional upper moiety which is compressing on the lower moiety, and that is why it kind of forms this drooping lily, because one, I am not seeing half the moiety, and second it is compressing on the lower moiety, leading to this drooping lily sign. Okay, so this is the whole explanation of drooping lily. Very, very important. Wiegert-Mayer, they keep asking in some form or the other. So this is something which is very important for you to understand. Okay, going on to the next image. Tell me, this cluster of image, what do you think is the diagnosis? No, not Bill. So Rachit, which sphincter are you talking about? These are both duplicated collecting systems of the kidney, correct? So here in the kidney itself, you have two sphincters. Are you talking about the insertion of the ureter? If you're talking about the insertion, yes, this ectopic insertion of the upper moiety, again, vowels sticking together, will be inferomedial. Alright, this will be inferomedial to the trigone. Whereas the lower moiety kind of inserts normally, or you can say superolaterally to the upper moiety. Okay, I hope that was your question. Okay, so yes, as everybody has correctly diagnosed this, this is indeed prune belly syndrome. Very nice. So this is something which is an expected image cluster. So what do you see in prune belly? As the name suggests, there is deficiency of the abdominal muscles. Alright, so the abdomen, anterior abdominal wall muscles will be deficient, because of which you have this prunated prune kind of an appearance. Okay, plus what do you see on the x-ray? That because the muscles are deficient, all the bubble loops are kind of coming out. They're all protruding from this weakened skin of the baby. Okay, so that is what we are seeing. And apart from that, this is the main primary thing that will help you identify this. Apart from that, it's associated with various other things. So two main problems. One, it's undescended testis. So UDT is one issue. Second issue is all your genitourinary abnormality. So urinary counterpart, what will we see? So as you can see here in this MCU that I'm showing you, look at the bladder. The bladder appears like a very, very elongated vertical structure. Correct. So here you will have bladder deformities. Look at the posterior urethra. Posterior urethra is very, very vertically oriented. So what you will find here, it's basically a vertically oriented posterior urethra. Okay, so this is something which is quite important. Apart from that, you can also have reflux, like you are finding here. You can have hydrouretronephrosis, reflux, vertically oriented bladder and posterior urethra. So these are the various anomalies that can be associated with prune belly syndrome. Okay, so this is about prune belly, very important image cluster to identify. Okay, What do I have here? Again, something very easy, something that you just can't afford to get wrong as far as exams are concerned. We are seeing that both the calluses, particularly the inferior pole, we can see that the pelvic callosal system are all trying to meet. They are trying to shake their hands, correct? And they are also located more inferiorly. So I noticed that the kidneys are oriented inferiorly. They are malrotated, facing medially to each other. So it is nothing but the horseshoe kidney. Alright, so this is the horseshoe kidney. This sign very famously has been called shaking hand calluses, or it has also been referred to as a flower vase. If you look very closely, it looks like a flower vase. Okay, so these are the two names that has been given to it, and it's because of the connected isthmus, correct? It's the connected isthmus inferiorly that you are seeing that they are both appearing like this. You are seeing this medial rotation of the kidneys coming close near the inferior pole. And where is this isthmus located? That is again an important applied anatomy question. So when the kidneys are ascending up from the pelvis during embryogenesis, what will happen? They will get stuck. The inferior most ventral branch of the aorta, which is inferior mesenteric artery, will prevent the ascent of this kidney. All right, and because of that, we will find that they are stuck inferiorly than usual at the level of L3. Okay, so their isthmus will be located at the level of L3, getting obstructed by IMA above. Okay, so this is about horseshoe kidney that you need to know. Now going ahead to the next image spotter. So what do I have here? What are the arrows showing us? That inferiorly, towards the inferior part of the ureters are both approximating each other. Can you see this? That they're coming closer. So this appears like a maiden waist, where you have a very narrow waist that is expected of maidens apparently. So this is a maiden waist deformity that you will have, and this is associated with what? What is pulling the ureters closer? What is pulling the ureters more medially? It is the fibrosis, alright? It's the retroperitoneal fibrosis which is pulling the ureters close to each other. Okay, so remember, this is seen with RPF. Now there are multiple causes of retroperitoneal fibrosis that we have. Okay, so one of which, if you can't find anything, it is primary, called, yes, as Ritwik is correctly saying, it is called Ormond disease. Correct, this is primary when no cause is found. But apart from that, there can be multiple other causes, one of which is very important now becomes IgG4 related disease, where we know it's a multisystemic lymphoplasmacytic sclerosing disease, where you have inflammation, then you have fibrosis. Correct, so this is one important disease. Apart from that, various drugs, particularly remember beta blockers, methysergide, can cause this. Okay, very important. Apart from that, yes, radiotherapy, as a lot of you are saying, can also cause this. Okay, so these are the various causes. Remember, lymphoma also, secondary to lymphoma also, when they get treatment, you will have fibrosis which can result in this. Okay, so this is about retroperitoneal fibrosis, medial deviation of the ureter. Okay, now going on to the next one. So two same appearances, but different diseases, same sign. So both of these cases, I have a description of hook-like ureter, but completely different things. So when you have a proximal hook or a J-shaped ureter, or described as proximal hook, what is this? Yes, very nice. This is retrocaval ureter. So abnormality of the IVC or ureter, kiski galti hai isme? IVC ka galti hai ya fir ureter ka galti hai? It is IVC ka galti, alright? So IVC is not formed properly. We have studied this in detail. I am not going into supracardinal, subcardinal again. But basically the IVC is not formed properly, because of which you have the ureter which is getting obstructed. It goes behind. So it's a retrocaval ureter. It has to go behind the IVC. It gets obstructed. So this is your proximal hook-like ureter. On the other hand, when you have bilaterally, both the ureters becoming hook-shaped, becoming more horizontal and more superior. Why is this? What is this hole filling defect? I'll tell you, this is an older male patient who's having lower urinary tract symptoms. So this is because of BPH most of the times, correct? So this is because of BPH when both the ureters now have to go more superiorly and more hook-like, basically projection will form. So this is because of the median lobe that is projecting, which is also called as the uvula, which gets dilated and forms this filling defect over the bladder. Okay, so this is your hook-like ureter, more distally. Okay, so same appearance, two diseases. Be careful in the exam what they are trying to ask. Okay, what do we have here? I'm showing you an ultrasound showing multiple black lesions, multiple cysts which are in the kidney. So I'm telling you, I kept the probe in the flank and this is what I saw. I never saw the kidneys. I saw that the kidneys were enlarged, basically what looked like kidneys were enlarged and replaced by innumerable cysts. All right, so what is this in an adult? Autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease. And what will happen to the pelvic alveolar system? So bichara PCS gets played because of all of these multiple cysts. It is just trying to find its place somewhere and it gets completely splayed and it looks like a spider leg. Can you see this, how splayed the pelvic alveolar system is? It is just trying to find its place somewhere in this cyst ka mela. Okay, so this is spider leg appearance which is seen with autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease. One name that you can remember, Ravin criteria, is used for the diagnosis of ADPCKD, where you have an age-wise criteria. With age, the number of cysts that are required to make this diagnosis kind of increases. You don't need to remember this, just remember that there's something called as Ravin criteria for ADPCKD. On the other end of the spectrum, if I just have to tell you, ARPCKD. So this is something which will present in infancy. All right, and infancy, here the patients will come to you with renal failure. All right, so here you will have that bilateral kidneys will be enlarged. So you will definitely observe bilateral renomegaly. However, the obvious kind of cysts, alright, the obvious kind of cyst that we were seeing, tell detail of what, Rachit? So ARPCKD, I am about to tell. Okay, so here what we will find is that both the kidneys are gonna be very, very large. Okay, and I will not find the cyst that I was finding here. In ADPCKD, we're finding these very, very large cysts that I will not find. But what will I find? I will find these tiny, tiny cysts here. Can you see these very, very tiny cysts? So overall, the kidneys will appear like bilateral increased echogenic. All right, so they'll appear like increased echogenic kidneys rather than having those cysts, because these are very tiny microscopic cysts that you will observe here. And pathologically, they tell you something very important here, that the outer surface of the kidney, when you look at the gross specimen also, here will be smooth. All right, it'll be smooth here in ARPCKD, whereas in the ADPCKD you will have those cysts which are bumping out and you won't have an outer smooth surface. Okay, is that fine, everybody? Ravin criteria, you don't really need to know the details. I mean, less than 30, you need 4 cysts in both the kidneys. It's like that. Alright, the number of cysts, basically depending on the age, you need to know. Again, there is a very big list where you have family history to be taken into account, no family history. So I don't think it's worth it going into it at all. Alright, it won't be asked to you, because again, there's a lot of variation also in the various criteria that are there in literature. So don't go into it. But the difference between ADPCKD, ARPCKD appearance, that is something that you need to understand. Okay, so this is what you need to know. Now coming to one more appearance, what are we seeing here? We are seeing that this is the right kidney. Left kidney, instead of being on the left side where it was supposed to be, because it's left kidney, what am I seeing? I'm seeing that it is now here on the right side, and I'm finding that both of them are quite close to each other. Do you see this? Both are quite close. So how do I know it's not a duplicated system, right? It could very well be a duplicated system, but it is not, because what do I see? This left kidney ureter is crossing over and draining where it was supposed to be. So I know that this is left for sure, and the kidney has now ectopically come towards the right side. It has crossed over. Very nice. So this is called crossed ectopia. Now this can be of two types. All right, this can be either fused or it can be unfused. Will I know this on IVP? Will I know if the parenchyma is fused or unfused on IVP? No, I can't. So for this, I need either CT or MR or some sort of 3D investigation which will tell me about the parenchyma. Okay, whether the parenchyma is fused or whether the parenchyma is unfused, but this just basically tells me, the IVP tells me that there is crossed ectopia. Okay, this is something which is important, I feel. This is something which is not something we routinely learn for PG, but this can be tested. Okay, so this is again one anomaly, crossed ectopia, more commonly crossed fused ectopia, but you can't say that on IVP. So notice that the ureter basically crosses to the normal side. That is something which is important. All right. Fine, going to the next image. So what do I have here? First of all, focus on the x-ray, not on the IVP, focus on the x-ray. What do I see here? So here you have an appearance, something like a manta ray. Aisa lag raha hai ki, the fish is coming with you with the open rays, correct? So this is called as manta ray appearance. And what does it suggest? It basically suggests a pubic diastasis. Do you see this, that the pubic symphysis is not formed, it is not closed, there is very very wide open pubic diastasis. And why is this seen? This is seen because of ectopia vasaicae. Alright, this is seen with ectopia vasaicae or bladder extrophy. And what will happen to the ureter? So focus here, what happens to the ureter is that the ureter become more horizontal. They appear like hurley stick. So this is called as hurley stick appearance, which is associated with ectopia vasaicae or bladder extrophy. And this becomes a risk factor for what? Remember, this is a risk factor for which type of bladder CA? Adenocarcinoma. Okay, so all the vowels sticking together again. So you have adenocarcinoma, ectopia, extrophy, all of these things which are associated with each other. All right, so this is ectopia vasaicae. Going ahead to the next image, here you just need to know a few signs basically. So what do I observe in the papillae basically? I am seeing that there are these sloughed off particles. Do you see this? That the papilla is not smooth. There are sloughed off particles that I am seeing, which suggests that there is some necrosis which has happened. So this is papillary necrosis, and you have three named signs here. Alright, so they can ask you as one liners, you have three named signs which you need to know. One is called a signet ring sign. Where else do we see signet ring sign, guys? Type in your comments. Kahan kahan milta hai signet ring? Apart from that, I also see lobster claw. This some people it looked like a lobster claw, and also this is called as ball on T sign. So signet ring, where all do we see? Still not getting your comments. One, bronchiectasis is where I see a signet ring sign. And one more place which is thoda sa lesser heard. Okay, you see this in something where you see Terry Thomas sign. I'll give you a hint. Where in the wrist do I see Terry Thomas? Ye to sabko aata hai, hai na? So Terry Thomas, very nice, Ritwik, is seen with scapholunate dislocation. So in scapholunate dislocation, no, if you look at the scaphoid bone basically, it appears like a signet ring. It appears like this bone basically because of its orientation. So this is also one place where I see signet ring sign. Alright, so three places signet ring. Fine, so this is papillary necrosis. You all know the causes like diabetes, TB, NSAIDs intakes or analgesic nephropathy. You basically have sickle cell anemia. So all of these are causes of papillary necrosis. Going ahead, yes, apart from that, yes, gastric malignancy also you have signet ring, but that is again pathology, right? Okay, so if we have to go into path, tell me where, what are the two malignancies where I expect signet ring morphology? What are the two places, both of which have E. cadherin mutation? Tell me then in path, where do we see E. cadherin mutation which results in this signet ring kind of appearance? One, it's definitely gastric malignancy, correct. And which is the other one, in the breast, in females? Yes, it is lobular CA, correct. So both of these are again associated with CDH mutation, 11th chromosome, hai na? So dono mein you will also have signet ring. Okay, okay. So coming back to our radiology business, what do I have here? Here we have a very very typical paint brush appearance, right? We have a paint brush appearance that we are seeing. And this has also been likened to as a flower bouquet. Bouquet of flowers or flower bouquet appearance. And where do we see this? So if you notice, what can I see? This is the excreted contrast. And I can see that in the medullary pyramids, there are these striated white calcifications which are there. Alright, so this is associated with medullary nephrocalcinosis, typically in a disease called medullary sponge kidney. Okay, so this is medullary sponge kidney disease or medullary nephrocalcinosis, where you have this striated calcification that you can see along the medullary pyramids. Okay, so this is bouquet of flowers. Going ahead to three images, so tell me the diagnosis. Tell me the diagnosis. One, I am showing you a CCT and I can see that in the right kidney there is a mass, and very typical mass because it has this central stellate scar. Can you see this, that there is a central stellate scar that I am seeing here in this particular renal mass? And what is the renal mass with a stellate scar? It is very nice. It is oncocytoma, and it can also be a chromophobe RCC, a distinction that I can't make on radiology, correct? So oncocytoma, chromophobe RCC, best prognosis. The renal cell tumor with the best prognosis is this one. What do I see on CT?
What do I see on CT? I see that there is pneumothorax. Do you see this? There is pneumothorax on the right side. Why is there pneumothorax? I want to know the cause. So I further zoom in and I see that there are many cysts in the lung. There are so many cysts which are subpleural also. So one of these cysts must have ruptured. So what do I see? I see that there are lung cysts and the lung cysts have ruptured, leading to pneumothorax. And what is happening to the face of this person? There are these tiny, tiny follicular lesions, right? So I can say that these are fibrofolliculomas or follicular tumors. So a cluster of these three makes the diagnosis as Bott-Hogg-Duppe syndrome, as a lot of you picked it up. And this is because of which mutation? It's a mutation of the folliculin gene. Which chromosome? Did somebody tell me the chromosome here of the folliculin gene? Is located on chromosome 17. Okay, so this is Bott-Hogg-Duppe syndrome. Please remember this cluster: renal oncocytoma, lung cysts, and fibrofollicular lesions. Okay, wonderful. Going ahead to one mass here, which is where, first of all, I need to figure out where is this located, correct? That is how my approach begins. First location, then character. So if I look at the image, this is a CT. First of all, it's a contrast enhanced CT. There's a very black colored mass. This is something which is striking. Now talking about location, this is the right kidney. Can I say that it is sitting on the top of right kidney? It is not really originating from the right kidney. It is more like compressing. Do you guys notice this? Ki kidney mein se nahi nikal raha. It's not infiltrating into the kidney. It's forming this compression, right? It is embedding the kidney, basically making it go down. So this is most likely from the suprarenal location. Okay, so this is suprarenal. That is my epicenter. And now going on to the character. Okay, so what is the character? It's very, very black. Anytime I see a black mass, now my first tendency is to compare it with something which is normal, which is subcutaneous fat. Does it have a similar sort of color? Yes. So anytime you see this black negative HU on CT, I know that it is fatty. So now our job is simple. I have to find a fat containing tumor of the adrenal. What is that? Very nice, Ritwik. So it is something called adrenal myelolipoma. So everybody, one clarification: in your exam you will have one option as renal angiomyolipoma, correct? That is one obvious differential that comes to mind. So renal angiomyolipoma will not have this sort of compression of the kidney. It will arise from the kidney. You will see a beak from the kidney, correct? So when you see a fat containing mass of the kidney, think of angiomyolipoma. But when it is arising from the adrenal, the tumor you have to think of is myelolipoma. Myeloid cell plus fat cell, myelolipoma. Please remember this. Okay, apart from that, one more differential which is fat containing is a primary retroperitoneal liposarcoma. Have you heard of retroperitoneal liposarcoma? It's one of the very, very common malignant neoplasms of the retroperitoneum. So if it is not from the adrenal, it can also be this liposarcoma. So remember these three differentials, fat containing in the same neighborhood. Okay, so this is about that. Thank you, Ankita. Thank you for your sweet comment. And going on to one more image here. So I tell you, it's a child. All right, it's a child who is having this appearance. Very, very typical characteristic appearance that you have. When the adrenal glands, look at this adrenal, white Y-shaped adrenal. What is happening? So there is calcification. So whenever I see bilateral adrenal calcification in a child, I have to think of one disease. Very nice. It is the Wolman disease. And what is the enzyme which is deficient here in Wolman disease? Very, very important. So it is the lysosomal acid lipase which is basically deficient here, which results in the deposition of all of these tissues here, which undergo saponification, and there is adrenal calcification because of that. Okay, so very, very typical radiological appearance. You just can't think of anything else. But if I tell you ki bachcha nahi hai, it is not a congenital disease, it's not autosomal recessive congenital disease, it's a grown, full grown adult who never had this before, but now he is having this. So what infection do I have to rule out in an adult when I see bilateral adrenal calcification? One important DD in our country, this DD should always pop up in your mind anytime you have calcification where it doesn't belong. So it is definitely tuberculosis. So remember, TB end stage will result in calcification. You can have bilateral adrenal calcification in TB in the end stage when you have adrenals which are getting अफेक्टेड. ओके, सो वन इम्पॉर्टेंट डिफरेंशियल फॉर यू इन अडल्ट्स. प्लीज बच्चों में डोंट मार्क टीबी, बच्चों में मार्क वॉलमेंट्स. इन अडल्ट्स आई एम टेलिंग यू जस्ट कीप दिस इन द बैक ऑफ योर माइंड. ओके फाइन, गोइंग अहेड, वन मोर इमेज एंड देन वी कैन मे बी स्टॉप. वट आर वी हैविंग हियर? वी हैव दैट देर इज अ फाइन, आई एम टेलिंग यू इट्स जस्ट अ बॉर्न, अभी न्यू बॉर्न बेबी है विथ दिस ह्यूज मास कमिंग आउट ऑफ हिज अबडोमन. वट इज दिस? सो ऑन दी एक्सरे कैन यू जस्ट सी दैट फ्रॉम द पेल्विस ही इज हैविंग दिस ह्यूज मास विच इज कमिंग डाउन, विच इज प्रोट्रूडिंग. सो वट इज द मोस्ट कॉमन कंजेनिटल ट्यूमर? बस इतना सा सवाल, वन लाइनर. मोस्ट कॉमन कंजेनिटल ट्यूमर इन बेबीज, इट इज टेरेटोमा, राइट? सो इट इज टेरेटोमा एंड द मोस्ट कॉमन लोकेशन इज द सेक्रोकॉक्सिजल टेरेटोमा. ऑलराइट, सो रिमेंबर, सेक्रोकॉक्सिजल टेरेटोमा विल अराइज लाइक दिस मोस्ट कॉमनली एंड इट कैन हैव अ वेरी लार्ज एक्सोफाइटिक कॉम्पोनेंट ग्रोइंग आउट ऑफ द बॉडी. इट कैन हैव अ कॉम्पोनेंट दैट्स ग्रोइंग इन टू द अबडोमन एज वेल. सो दे कैन बी वेरियस टाइप्स एंड इट कैन ग्रो एनी वेयर इट बेसिकली वॉन्ट्स. एंड ऑन द एम आर आई कैन यू सी दिस दैट फ्रॉम द सेक्रोकॉक्सिजल लोकेशन यू आर हैविंग दिस हेट्रोजिनस ट्यूमर. दिस द यू बी विच इज गेटिंग पुश्ड एंटीरियरली. सो दिस इज द टेरेटोमा दैट यू नीड टू बेसिकली नो. जस्ट वन थिंग, वेर डज इट अराइज? यस, वेरी नाइस डॉक्टर गुरु. सो इट अराइजेस फ्रॉम समथिंग कॉल्ड एज नोड ऑफ हेंसन. ओके, सो इट अराइजेस फ्रॉम दिस रेसिड्यूअल प्रिमिटिव स्ट्रीक विच इज लोकेटेड हियर. यस वाबी साबी, द PDF आई विल पोस्ट ऑन द ग्रुप. ओके, सो वंस दिस क्लास इज ओवर आई पोस्ट yesterday's एंड today's बोथ द PDFs ऑन द ग्रुप, annotated ones. Alright, so this I was saying will arise from the node of Hansen. Apart from this, like all teratomas, here you will have raised beta HCG levels, okay, and you will have also raised alpha fetoprotein levels. Because it's a teratoma, it can have variety of tissues. Okay, so this is about teratoma. One last image, final image, something that you just can't miss in life or in exam, very very important. So what I can see here is that there is air. There is air in the shape of the kidney where it doesn't belong. So what do I see? Again, on the CT, I am seeing that the kidney is completely replaced by this black air foci, and the kidney is completely destroyed. So many abscesses, so many air foci. Yes, so this is emphysematous pyelonephritis. This is emphysematous pyelonephritis, a very, very bad condition to have. Very poor prognosis will occur because of gram-negative infection. Patients most likely will go into sepsis, and a lot of times you will have to do an urgent nephrectomy in order to save the patient. But the first line management, what will you do immediately? Something, you have to drain it out. Alright, so an urgent pigtail drainage is usually preferred. Under ultrasound guidance, we will try and put in the pigtail in one of these collections and drain out as much pus as possible so that we can save the patient from going into sepsis. Okay, so this is emphysematous. This is just a spotter that can, you know, it's a very definitive imaging finding that you just can't miss in your exam. So air foci in the shape of kidney, CT or X-ray. Emphysematous pyelonephritis. Okay guys, so that is it for today. I hope this was useful, a short quick 30 minute session. We saw some high yield images like all weekends. Now I will meet you next Saturday with more images, half an hour episode. We will meet next week again. I hope this was useful. I'll post the PDF on the group, you can revise it for your advantage. Thank you very much, and I will see you all for toxicology session tonight at 9 o'clock. So please, if you want, you can attend that. It'll be useful is what I can tell you. Okay, bye, and